with this week comes from Harlow, which has both an old town and a new town. Now, this used to be a church which served half the old town. Hello.
Hello there.
I didn't expect you to drop in. How you do?
Well, thank you.
What's your name?
Tony Bartels.
What are you doing up there?
I've been helping to restore the clock.
So, I mean, is that a regular thing you do then?
Oh, no, it's just a part-time, just as a hobby.
It's interesting that a redundant church has become a focal point for the rest of the community, isn't it? What happens here? What sort of things go on?
Well, it's quite a few activities go on, from karate, painting, table tennis, covering virtually all age groups.
So people come here and have a good time?
Yes, yes.
Tony was just one of many people who had been drawn into the life of St. John's. It's well placed, too. The recreation centre fits snugly into one of the little streets which branch off the marketplace in Old Harlow. This little spot, unspoiled by development, is the nucleus of the much larger area we now know as Harlow. That's why it seems right that this particular place should have been adopted by one of the town's most prestigious groups, the Harlow Chorus, whose musical director is Michael Kibblewhite.
The Harlow Chorus of rehearsal, and that's unmistakably Herbert Howells. This choir was formed soon after the new town of Harlow was built, and a finer example of common activity you couldn't wish for.
We must get that turnover sorted out better. It's a quaver entry at the top of page 54. He will not suffer by foot. Everybody, particularly loads of basses over there, get over quicker, please. So can we go once more from the top of page 53, first bar, we'll go from behold. OK, so are you ready? One, two.
Behold, Jesus,
the original town of Harlow consisted of small medieval villages, or wards, like this one at Churchgate Street. Each one was a group of houses clustered around its own church. These little village clusters formed some of the most beautiful and elegant parts of Harlow in the 1980s. The High Street in Old Harlow has won awards for the way in which it's been adapted to meet the pressures of the late 20th century. But it was the pressures of the mid-20th century, of Britain's recovery from the Second World War, that brought Harlow rocketing into the public eye. It was here that the government decided to build a new home for the refugees from a shattered city of London.
And this is obviously a planned town centre. All of mankind's needs are catered for within a few yards of each other. The spiritual, the cultural, and the educational. And people were brought here as part of a deliberate scheme.
Harlow was the first among the new town schemes. The High, as this is called, was carved out from green fields, which until then had been helping to feed the nation at war. So the war-weary but resilient Londoners came to live alongside their country cousins, people who needed help and acceptance from each other. Among them was a family of Richard Bryant, who sings with Cantabile. Those days were fraught with difficulties, but, as we know, nothing's impossible.
Life is not on song, when things keep going wrong. You won't be blue, I'm telling you, here's what you gotta do. You gotta remember, nothing's impossible, I'll be bound. So when your chin is on the ground, just pick yourself up, dust yourself off, start all over again. Furthermore, don't lose your confidence if you slip. Be grateful for a pleasant trip. And pick yourself up, dust yourself up, start all over again. Work like a man inspired, till the battle of the day is won. You may be sick and tired, but you'll be a man, my son. Just remember those famous men who had to fall to rise again. So pick yourself up, dust yourself down, start all over again.
Don't be discouraged if people don't cheer.
so ready to sneer.
Just remember,
they all laughed at Christopher Columbus when he said the world was round.
They all laughed when Edison recorded sound. They all said we never could be happy. They laughed at us and how. A man inspired till the battle of the day won. You may be sick and tired, but you'll be a man, my son. Just remember those famous men who had to fall to rise again. So pick yourself up, ride up, dust yourself down, ride down.
I said that Harlow provided for all the needs of mankind, including the educational. So every morning in term time...
Tremendous. Now, a lot of clergymen today seem to dispense with a clerical collar, but you wear yours deliberately, don't you?
Yes, that's right. When I was appointed, very few people knew who I was. It was a new college. And it seemed important in a big anonymous place to be open about who I was and what I was doing. And so I decided I would wear it.
Of course, because you wear the collar, people come to you, do they?
That's right, yes. I think if you're around the place and you're seen, and people build up some kind of relationship with you, then they're willing to come along to talk about more difficult things.
What's the job of a counsellor?
Really, to spend time listening to people work through things that are troubling them.
Yeah.
And helping them see ways they could cope better.
Of course, it must take a lot of courage to come and knock on your door.
Yeah, it can be very difficult. Counselling itself can be quite painful.
Yeah.
Because you're finding out things about yourself that maybe you didn't want to know.
Oh, is that right?
That's right. Yeah. And I've known people who've had to walk around the block for 3/4 of an hour before they could come and knock on the door. But when they've done it, when they've summoned the courage, it hurts, but maybe it heals as well.
Yeah. There's no doubt that Gary's work fits well into the college curriculum, helping students to find their way into life. And that's not just a principle that applies to young people fresh out of school. The process of helping each other to explore the rich potential that life offers can begin much later, as I discovered among the Access group.
I think some of us had regrets of not staying on and going straight on to college from school. It's sort of like the wasted years of thinking, my God, after bringing up your children, saying, I'm capable of doing much more than just being a housewife and a mother, and saying I can do something good.
When I came on the Access course, I didn't know exactly which avenue I wanted to explore, and I thought perhaps I'd be the only one like that, and there's others that weren't quite so sure either. And it's nice to know that there was support, there were people that you could talk to, and perhaps if you're having difficulties and think, well, you know, which way do I go, there might be someone else that would say, I'm also feeling like that, and you discuss it and you find a way out, and it's the support that's there all the time.
I think you find though that Access is just, it's more than just an opportunity to get to higher education. Actually, the whole person is learning and developing. I mean, you learn so much from other people, don't you? So much about the community.
Yes,
I mean,
it's not just
my
the
mind
academic.
Is much more open now. Yeah. I can go out and I can be more receptive, more sensitive to other people's feelings and so on, and that's very important, I feel.
The Access group is part of the essential process of people helping one another to develop and meet new challenges. On the outskirts of Harlow, another lesson is going on, more sophisticated maybe, but with exactly the same principles. The harpsichordist Virginia Black is working with a student, Helen Rogers.
Thank you. can I just stop you there? Well done, that's a lot better. If you can just get a little bit more of this guitar sound, the Spanish element in the piece, in that left hand, can I just show you?
Black is certainly one of the most accomplished harpsichord players this country has produced. But she told me that teaching and passing on her understanding by helping young people to develop into the world of music is the most important part of her work. Helping other people, which is no more than obeying the third commandment, love thy neighbor, comes in many guises. For some, it's motivated by religion. For some, by music. For Denise James and her husband, it's a pure social conscience. They run Harlow Community Chest, a fund of money to which people can apply when they're in desperate need. 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100. Borrowing the town hall car park on a Saturday is just one way of raising that money. One of the things I noticed when I visited Harlow was that you don't have to dig very deep before you find a whole network of ways in which people rely upon each other. I believe people who hang about and say, there's nothing happening in Harlow, haven't even skimmed the surface. I proved that when I visited the dry ski slope.
And here's an example of people helping each other in a completely different way. Not every problem can be solved with money. That man over there is teaching handicapped people to ski.
Mike Hammond is the manager of the Hammersholt Road Ski Centre. He's been a very successful competition skier. If people in Harlow get extra enjoyment on their winter holiday, it's probably due to him. He was one of the founder members of the National Handicapped Skiers Association. He's well qualified. He lost a leg after a terrible accident, and now he teaches others to persevere as he did. Handicapped people need the stimulus and therapy of physical exercise just as much as others. The Handicapped Skiers Association give their expertise to bring the sheer thrill of skiing to everybody. There's no handicap Mike Hammond can't cope with. The paraplegic, the limbless, and even the blind. In discovering the network of fine people who help each other in Harlow, I inevitably found some real and perhaps disturbing truths about humanity. Real solutions, after all, only grow from real problems. And as Christians, we must learn to face up to and heal the wounds caused by those problems. Every society has its worthless waste, its corruption, and its degeneration, if you like. But only the finest people are strong enough to turn a spiritual desert caused by that pollution into a fertile oasis of joy by leading others out of that desert. It was here in the churchyard of St. Mary Latin that one such story began.
I've come here to talk to Pat. I can't tell you her surname for obvious reasons, but her story is both harrowing and uplifting. Pat, now, you yourself were an incest victim.
Yes.
So tell us a bit about what happened to you.
Well, I was abused by my father as a child, and I never told anyone. And it had, you know, quite bad effects over a period of my life. And as far as I was concerned, I was never going to tell anyone anyway.
And then there was a crisis one day. Your sister was ill, wasn't she?
Yes, my sister was dying, and I was becoming very depressed again. And somehow I thought it should have been me. Why was she suffering when I was the guilty, nasty, dirty one?
Yeah.
So I started talking to the curate at our church about my sister. And I must have said something to him, that they know that there's something much worse going on for me. And he suggested that I had counselling. And I didn't really understand what that was.
No, yeah.
And I agreed to that, and I went along with a friend. And after quite a lot of time, you know, I eventually told him what had happened, and that was the start of me becoming a person.
And then you decided to do something to help others in a similar situation, didn't you?
Well, I kept thinking, you know, I always thought I was the only one. And so I got in touch with someone called Jean Houlihan, who was a social worker who'd known me for quite some time. We decided that we would open a telephone line 1 hour a week, and perhaps someone would ring us.
Yeah.
And perhaps start a group. But it's just grown and grown from there. We've had nearly 3,000 calls. We have several.
Is that, yeah?
Yes, and they come from all over Essex and as far as Lincolnshire and places like that, because there's not much else around. And of course we work with the children, and the ages range from the youngest one we've been asked to help is a 2-year-old.
Good heavens.
And the eldest one we're helping is a 70-year-old, so there's a big age.
Obviously. How is your faith, and how do you feel about Christianity now?
Well, my faith does play a big part in my life, although it's very painful. I have not got what I call an easy faith. And, you know, when I see the pain and the suffering, like today, you know, I had a 2-year-old child and a 4-year-old child. You think, you know, God, why are you on one long bank holiday? And you see the suffering that these children have gone through, you know, a lot of these children, you know, I've been raped by the age they're 2. And I get very angry with God. And at one time I did try giving up being a Christian, but I couldn't cope with not being one.
You see it as a battleground then?
I see it, yes, but I always go back. I mean, in my air of desperation always. I can't live without it.
Finally, Pat, what would you advise people to do to help themselves in similar situations?
I always say, don't keep it to yourself anymore, because those that are adults, especially those that are adult survivors out there, they know what it feels like. They know the depression, the pain, and all the really negative self-worth feelings that go with it. And for the children also, you know, do tell. If the children tell now, you know, not only would it stop the suffering that they're going through now, but we could give them a chance. They can have chance to be children, proper children.
Then a woman said, speak to us of joy and sorrow. And he answered, your joy is your sorrow, unmasked. And the self-same well from which your laughter rises was oftentimes filled with your tears. And how else can it be? The deeper that sorrow carves into your being, the more joy you can contain. Is not the cup that holds your wine the very cup that was burned in the potter's oven? And is not the lute that soothes your spirit the very wood that was hollowed with knives? When you're joyous, look deep into your heart, and you shall find it is only that which has given you sorrow that is giving you joy. There are those who give with joy, and that joy is their reward. And there are those who give and know not pain in giving, nor do they seek joy, nor give with mindfulness of virtue. Through the hands of such as these, God speaks, and from behind their eyes, he smiles upon the earth.
That was Caroline John. Now here's a song that tells us when the world seems a better place, on a clear day. I've chosen to sing that song in this particular place for a very special reason. The church where Gary Neave is the honorary curate. In fact, he's waiting in there for me now. Hello, Gary.
Nice to see you again.
Now, do you feel there's a continuity between your life in the church and your work in the college?
Yes, I do, I think. Partly because both of them are about trying to find out something about the truth and trying to live it.
Yeah.
And we're both engaged in the same thing.
So where do you get your strength from then? You?
Well, for me, partly it's here. Mm. Partly it's through my faith, the belief I have, the belief that we're trying to find out what the truth is and live it as best we can. And for other people it might be different things. They might have different faiths, but I think unless you've got those resources to draw on, you're in danger of being the expert with all the answers and no weaknesses. And I don't believe people are like that. And I think often when you're weakest and when you're most human is when you're most used to people. So I think, yes, for me, my faith is the resource I draw from, and I find that here.
Now, you as a Christian get your strength by coming to church. What about people of other faiths?
I think it's important that whatever faith a person has, whether it's got a religious name or whether it's something they believe in very deeply, that they have something they can draw on, something they can turn to sustain them. And for someone of the Jewish faith, that might be their life in that community. For someone, it might be a set of beliefs that they hold very dearly and that they live their lives by. But whatever label it is, I think it's important that people have got those resources to draw on and a community to live in and to sustain themselves by.
So it was that Gary Neve began to answer some of the questions that Pat had asked. Whoever we are, however committed we are, we all need something to fall back on. Our resources, our faith, the community. The community of Harlow is symbolized by the splendid Harlow chorus, so it seemed apt that we should sing together in the Song of Joy.
It's always a special pleasure to sing with a good choir. They don't come any better than the Harlow Chorus. Thank you. Well, next week, Harvey comes to Barnstable in Devon. I'll see you then.
Your friend, Mrs. Williams.
No, she couldn't have done it. She was with the group all evening. It was Poindexter. Has to be.
I still can't make out why Kim was naked.
All right, then. Why are people naked?
To wash?
Yes. But what else? What else do people take their clothes off for?
Sunbathing? Come on, Lewis, you are the married man. Well, you don't take off all your clothes to do that. Not necessarily.
Well, a lot of people do, I'm told. So let's suppose... Just let's suppose that Dr. Theodore Kemp was making love to a lady. And since we know that lady couldn't be his wife because of the car crash,